folks, in this section I would like to talk about L'Hopital's rule, and we want to let f and g be functions that are differentiable on an open interval a, b, and that interval contains c, but the function doesn't have to necessarily be differentiable at c. Then we're going to assume that g prime of x, so the derivative of the function g, is not equal to zero for all the x values in that interval, except at possibly c. If we say f of x, if we take the limit of f of x over g of x as x approaches c, so that's what we have written here, and it produces an indeterminate form. And so what do we mean by an indeterminate form? I've got a list of them for you here. 0 over 0 is an indeterminate form. And we've dealt with that before, right? Remember we talked about we always had to simplify if you have a 0 over 0. But infinity over infinity is also an indeterminate form. Negative infinity over infinity, and you can move that negative all around, or they could both be negative. And then there are even other types of indeterminate forms, like if you take your limit and you get 1 to the infinity power, you can't necessarily say that's 1. Or if you get infinity to the 0 power, or 0 to the 0 power, you've probably run across that thought before, and infinity minus infinity, none of those can you say, well, the first one looks like it ought to be 1. It might not be. The next one, hard to even say what in the world that would be, right? Or 0 to the 0. You think it ought to be 0, but not necessarily, because these pieces of the function, the base to the exponent, might be approaching those values at different rates. So in the end, your answer for this one might not be 1. So anytime you have what's called these indeterminate forms, then there's something you can do. You can use L'Hopital's rule, which is awesome. You're going to wish we learned this earlier in the semester. But if you take the derivative of the numerator divided by the derivative of the denominator and take the limit again, you would have the same limit as the original function. Now, I'm not saying you use the quotient rule. You're not taking the derivative of a quotient. You're just separately taking the derivative of the numerator and the derivative of the denominator and taking the limit again. And these limits would be the same. As a matter of fact, you might find yourself taking the derivative a few times before you get the answer to your limit. But we'll do a bunch of problems and you'll see this in action. I guess I need to continue reading. It says, provided the limit on the right exists or is infinite, okay? So if you either get an answer, like for example, 5, or you get infinity or negative infinity, then you have your limit value. It says, this result also applies when the limit of f of x over g of x approaches c, as x approaches c, produces any of those other indeterminate forms. Now these down here at the bottom, they're a special case. And you see the way they're written right now, there's no way we can take the derivative of the numerator and the denominator, because there's not a numerator and denominator. So we'll have to do the work to these. But first, let's practice these 4 along with 0 over 0. So here's our first example. Now, y'all, we know how to take this limit. We've done this before. The limit is x goes to negative 4. The first thing you would do is just substitute negative 4, right? So you have 2 times negative 4 squared plus 13 times negative 4 plus 20 divided by negative 4 plus 4. Now, if you run those numbers, plug it in your calculator, you're going to get 0 over 0. Now, again, 0 over 0 is not 0. That's what we call an indeterminate form. And if it's on that list, you might find yourself having to go back to that list. But if you have anything on that list, and there's our list again, there's 0 over 0 right there, then you have an indeterminate form, and that's certainly not your answer. Now, we could, you remember how we would do this the old way? We know if it's 0 over 0, it's going to simplify. We would attempt to factor the numerator and factor the denominator, cancel any common factors, and take the limit again, and that would give us our result. Now, I'm going to spare you all those details because I know you know how to do that. Let's use L'Hopital's rule instead. So, I can take the limit as x approaches negative 4, and remember the rule said you take the derivative of the numerator, so that would be 4x plus 13, and then the derivative of 20, of course, is 0, divided by the derivative of the denominator. The derivative of x plus 4 is 1. and then you take the limit again. And if you get 0 over 0, then you take the derivatives of each of the numerator and denominator again. So plug in negative 4, that'd be 4 times negative 4 plus 13, which is going to be negative 16 plus 13, which is negative 3. Now, what if you weren't convinced of that? Now, the old way, and I'm not going to do them all the old way, but I guess I do need to do this one the old way, right? So I've got the limit as x approaches negative 4. Now, we talked about if you get 0 over 0, it requires simplifying. So we need to factor this. Now, I'm pretty sure that x plus 4 is going to be one of the factors, and that's why we got 0 over 0. So when I'm factoring, that's going to give me, what, 2x plus 5? We're going to check it, so it's 2x squared, let's put plus 8x plus 5x is 13x, yes. And these x plus 4s cancel, and then I substitute in negative 4, that'd be 2 times negative 4 plus 5, which is going to give me negative 3. So again, that's the old way, but using L'Hopital's rule to me is easier and required for some problems, and there's the new way, okay? Alright, so for example B, we've got the limit as x approaches 0 of sine of 6x over 4x. Now, I don't know if you remember the rule. I'm hoping that you do. If you take the limit as x approaches 0, so first of all, what if we just plug in 0? So that would be the sine of 6 times 0, which of course is 0, over 4 times 0, which is going to give us 0 over 0. Once again, we have an indeterminate form. Now, we had a theorem way back, I couldn't tell you what number it is, that says if these values match, so if we had the sine of 6x over 6x, and we were taking the limit as x goes to 0, then our answer would be 1. So we would do work to this to make these match on the inside. In other words, we'd pull 1/4 out and then multiply by 6 over 6, and that will give us our result. But since we have 0 over 0, why don't we try using L'Hopital's rule? So I'm going to take the limit as x approaches 0. Now, L'Hopital's rule means, remember, says you need to take the derivative of just the numerator. So the derivative of sine, we know, is cosine. But I'm using the chain rule. Rewrite the inside times the derivative of the inside. The derivative of 4x, now I'm taking the derivative of the denominator, is 4. And then we take the limit again. So now when I plug in 0, I would have 6. I'm going to move this back 6 in the front. Times the cosine of 6 times 0 over 4. Now the cosine of 6 times 0 is the cosine of 0, of course, over 4. Now remember the cosine of 0 is 1, so 6 times 1 over 4, which is going to give me 3 halves. Now, if we had used that property, the old theorem that says these have to match, and we pull the 1/4 out front, so this is the old way. We would pull a 1/4 out front, because you can do that when you take a limit, right? You can pull out a constant as x approaches 0 of sine of 6x over x. The 4 remembers out front. Now, these don't match. How can I make a match? I could put a 6 right here. And then I could also put a 6 out front to compensate for that 6. All right, and then take the limit again. So now I have a 6/4 in front, and the limit of this is 1. And that gives me 3/2 as well. But L'Hopital's rule just seems easier to me. It's easier to remember what to do. So you do get 3/2 no matter how you do it. But always for L'Hopital's rule, here's what I want you to make sure of. You must have one of the indeterminate forms. You can't just do it for any limit. It must be one of those indeterminate forms. Okay, problem C, we're taking the limit as x goes to infinity of x to the third plus 2x over 4 minus x. So again, if we plug in infinity, if you think about it, it's going to give you infinity to the third plus 2 times infinity over 4 minus infinity. Now, that's not actually a number, but look, if you add that together at the top, it's definitely going to give you infinity. And if you take 4 and you subtract infinity, it's going to give you negative infinity. Now, question is that an indeterminate form? And we could go back to the list and take a look right here. And notice right down here, we have an infinity over negative infinity, our third one over right there. So, yes, this is definitely an indeterminate form. And if you have an indeterminate form, then you're allowed to, remember, separately take the derivative of the numerator and denominator. So the derivative of x to the third plus 2x is 3x squared plus 2. The derivative of 4 minus x is negative 1. Now I take the limit again, and I have 3 times infinity squared plus 2 over negative 1. Well, that's just going to give me infinity, right? Now, really, the limit does not exist, but we always answer with infinity because it tells you exactly the behavior of the graph. When it doesn't exist, you want to know why it doesn't exist, and infinity answers that question. But you do understand what I'm saying about an indeterminate form. When you have infinity divided by negative infinity, these infinities, the rate that the function is going to these infinities, it varies. So one infinity might be a bigger infinity than the other, if that makes any kind of sense. And it should. Notice x to the third grows much faster than x to the first. Therefore, it's like the top wins out, right? It's going to plus infinity. It's just kind of a way to think about it. All right, might be worth pausing this one. Try it on your own, see how it goes. And so the first thing I need you to check is the fact that you have an indeterminate form, right? You only want to use L'Hopital's rule if you have an indeterminate form. Well, just imagine plugging in infinity. If I have natural log of infinity to the third divided by infinity squared minus 1. If you plug infinity in a natural log, you remember the natural log graph looks similar to that. The larger the x is, the larger the answer is. So it's like you get an infinity in the numerator. And when you square infinity and you subtract 1, you also have infinity in the denominator. So you do have an indeterminate form, which means I'm allowed to use L'Hopital's rule, which is great, right? So the derivative of natural log of x to the third, using the chain rule, that's 1 over x to the third times the derivative on the inside, which is 3x squared. That's just the derivative of the numerator. Now I'm going to take the derivative of the denominator, which is 2x minus 0, so just 2x. Now don't do anything until you simplify this. Okay, so when I simplify 3x squared divided by x to the third, I get 3 over x. And that's, remember, divided by 2 over x, I invert and multiply. So that's the limit as x goes to infinity of 3 over x times 1 over 2x, right? Which is really the limit as x goes to infinity of 3 over 2x squared. And I plug in infinity right there, and that takes me right to 0, right? Let's think about it. 3 over 2 times infinity squared. Does that help you out a little better? So if the top stays constant, and the bottom goes to infinity. We talked about this a long time ago. If you have a constant over infinity, that definitely goes to 0 because that fraction gets smaller and smaller and smaller. So we have our answer. Hey, I want to point something out. I just realized, let's go back to this problem real quick. You probably picked up on it, but I did make a mistake and I don't want to go back and fix it. So notice we had 3 times infinity squared plus 2, that's infinity. But listen, you still got to divide it by negative 1. That's negative infinity. I completely ignored the negative 1. Be very careful about that, okay? And then this problem, I noticed that I really didn't mean to do this to infinity. I wanted to take that limit to 1. So what I'd like to do is the next problem, let's revisit this problem. What if I said the limit is x goes to 1 of natural log of x to the third over x squared minus 1? And there's nothing wrong with this solution. If you're going to infinity, it is an indeterminate form. But let's do the same problem over again, but take the limit as x goes to 1. All right, folks, so here's the second D. We have the limit as x goes to 1 this time of natural log of x to the third over x squared minus 1. If we just substitute in 1, we would have the natural log of 1 to the third divided by 1 squared minus 1, right? So that'd be the natural log of 1 divided by 0. And we know the natural log of 1 is 0. So do we have an indeterminate form? We sure do. We can't say that 0 over 0 is 0. And the reason is the rate at which the numerator is approaching 0 is different than the rate than the denominator is approaching 0. So if one's faster than the other, it doesn't mean it necessarily goes to 0. So what do? Well, we've got this new thing we can do, which is called L'Hopital's rule. We take the limit as x approaches 1. We keep that. We take the derivative of the numerator. Something I could have done in the last problem that I didn't do also. But you know what? Whenever you have a logarithm, remember, and you have an exponent, you can move that exponent in front. Now, I'm not taking the derivative. I'm just rewriting the problem. What I'm writing right here is equivalent to our original problem. Now I'm going to use L'Hopital's rule. And a lot of times I'll make up a different symbol from L'Hopital's rule. So this is equivalent. The little star is just telling me I'm using L'Hopital's rule. The limit as x approaches 1. Now, the derivative of 3 natural log of x we know is 3 times 1 over x, which is just 3 over x, right? The derivative of the denominator is 2x. Now I could substitute 1 in again, and that would give me 3 over 1 divided by 2 times 1. In other words, that gives me 3 halves. So there we go. So you have an indeterminate form. You take the derivative of the numerator and the denominator separately. Try to take the limit again. And if you get an answer to the limit or plus or minus infinity, that means you're finished with the problem. If you get another indeterminate form, then you take the derivative of the numerator and denominator separately again. Okay, example E. Now again, I think it's worth pausing and go ahead and work this problem. First of all, determine if it's an indeterminate form, and then take the derivative of the numerator and denominator separately if it is an indeterminate form. So what do you think? If I substitute in infinity, that would give me e to the infinity squared. How big is that? It's huge, right? So that's definitely infinity in the numerator. If I plug infinity in the denominator, it'd be 1 minus infinity to the third. Well, 1 subtract infinity gives me negative infinity. Is this an indeterminate form? You bet. Since it is, that means I can use L'Hopital's rule, which means I'm going to take the derivative of the numerator. Now, you remember the derivative of e to the x is e to the x, but we don't have an x up there. We have an x squared. So I'm going to use the chain rule. So it's e to the x squared times the derivative of the exponent, which is 2x. And in the denominator, the derivative of 1 is 0, and the derivative of negative x to the third is negative 3x squared. Now, once again, I substitute in infinity. Well, in the numerator, I still definitely have infinity, because e to the infinity squared all by itself is infinity, and then 2 times infinity is an even bigger infinity. In the denominator, I also have infinity. What do? Well, I use L'Hopital's rule again. So I have the limit as x goes to infinity, the derivative of the numerator. Now, that's going to get kind of big. Oh, you know what? I could have simplified this before I moved on, right? I can cancel this x and one of those. That helps. Now let's take the derivative of that instead. So it'd be 2 e to the x squared times the derivative of the numerator, which is 2x. And the derivative of the denominator, which is just negative 3x, derivative is negative 3. Now if I plug infinity in there, I get infinity in the numerator, because it's 2 times e to the infinity times 2 times infinity, which is infinity. But negative 3 in the denominator. Now, a positive infinity divided by a negative 3 is going to give me negative infinity. Now, this is no longer an indeterminate form. That is my answer. So, I don't have to use L'Hopital's rule anymore. All right, our next problem. You might be thinking this looks a little bit different. First of all, let's determine what we have. Do we have an indeterminate form? So, if I substitute in 0, that would be the limit. Well, let's just substitute in 0. I don't need to write the limit again. 0 to the third would be 0 times cotangent of 0. Do you remember what cotangent of 0 is? You have to think about that for a minute. It's infinity. Do you remember what the cotangent graph looks like? You know, it has vertical asymptotes, and it looks like that, and repeats. So as we approach 0, that goes up to plus infinity, and then that might be harder to remember. Now, the next question is that an indeterminate form? So we go back and look at our list. Here's our list, right? And we had 0 times infinity. So now that we look at our list, notice we do have 0 times infinity. Now, if you've gone back and look at your paid attention, that wasn't on the list before. I had to add it because I remember, oh no, I don't have that one. But it really is an indeterminate form. If you think about it, if you have a product and one piece is going to zero times one piece is growing to infinity, you don't know which one is growing the quickest, right? It could, the zero could overtake the infinity, or the infinity could overtake the zero. Therefore, it is definitely an indeterminate form, and that is the one we have. We have zero times infinity. Now, the question is, what can we do? We have L'Hopital's rule that could help us out, but we don't have a fraction. Remember, you have to have a quotient to be able to use L'Hopital's rule. So what could I do? Well, what do you think about this? If I write this as the limit as x goes to 0 from the right-hand side, or it had to be from the right-hand side because we had to know that that was plus infinity. If I rewrite this as x to the third over tangent of x, you agree that now we have a fraction? And you think about your indeterminate form, that would give you a 0 in the numerator and a 0 in the denominator. See what I mean? So you're turning the indeterminate form into another type of indeterminate form, but it's a quotient, therefore we can use L'Hopital's rule. So here we go. Now I'm going to use L'Hopital's rule. X goes to 0 from the right. The derivative of the numerator is 3x squared. What's the derivative of tangent? Do you remember about secant squared of x? Now let's substitute 0 in and see what we get. So in the numerator, we get 3 times 0 squared. Of course, that's 0. What about in the denominator? Secant squared of 0. Now here's what I have to think about. You know, secant squared is really 1 over the cosine squared of 0, right? And cosine of 0 is 1, so it's 1 over 1 squared, which is 1. Hey, that's nice. 0 over 1 just gives me 0. So after we use L'Hopital's rule, we learn that the limit as x approaches 0 from the right of x to the third times cotangent of x is just 0. So the 0 wins out. So example G looks very similar, doesn't it? If I substitute infinity for each of my x values, that gives me infinity times tangent of 1 over infinity. Now that's equivalent to saying infinity times tangent. If you have 1 over infinity, that goes to 0, right? Constant over infinity goes to 0, tangent of 0, 0. So the type here is 0 times infinity. And we know that's an indeterminate form. If you go back and look at the list, remember that's the one that I was missing. Now, I put 0 times infinity, then infinity times 0 is the same idea. So we have another indeterminate form. Now, what's the thought? What could we do here? It's not really a quotient, right? We have a quotient inside tangent. The whole thing is not a quotient. So, what could we do? Well, we really want to rewrite our problem as a quotient. So, that would give me the limit as x approaches infinity. So, what do you want to do? I believe there are different ways to approach this problem and still possibly get the correct answer, but here's one way you could handle it. You could leave the tangent of 1 over x in the numerator, and watch this x right here. I'm going to take to the denominator and make it 1 over x. That's an equivalent expression, right? And it is a quotient now, which means I can use L'Hopital's rule. And again, it's just me, but instead of just writing straight up equals, I like to tell myself, hey, I'm doing something different to this thing. I'm using L'Hopital's rule, and that's just a notation that I use personally. So tangent of 1 over x, you know, the derivative of tangent is secant squared. After we write the inside times the derivative of the inside, because I'm using the chain rule, and that's just in the numerator, the derivative of 1 over x, or you can think as x to the negative 1, will be negative x to the negative 2 power. Again, what did I do right there? I was thinking about the inside is that. Move the negative 1 in front and reduce that by 1. Okay. And in the denominator, I'm also going to have the derivative of 1 over x. Again, I'm thinking about that as x to the negative 1. So the derivative of the denominator is going to be negative x to the negative 2 power. Now, watch this. I can cancel this negative x to the negative 2 and this that negative x to the negative 2. And I'm going to be taking the limit as x goes to infinity of secant squared of 1 over x, which will be secant squared of 1 over infinity. And we'll see what happens there. 1 over infinity is 0, right? So secant squared of 0. Now secant is really 1 over the cosine squared of 0. We know cosine of 0 is 1, so that'd be 1 over 1 squared. Finally, that gives me an answer of 1. So this limit value is 1. Alright, so here's an interesting problem. First, let's check our form. So if I plug 0 in here, you know, if you have 1 over 0, this denominator is going to 0, that makes this go to infinity. So it's like you have an infinity plus 1, which is still infinity, and then I plug in 0 up here, that's infinity to the 0. Now, question is that an indeterminate form? Is it on our list? And notice it's right there second in that list at the bottom. So infinity to the 0 power is definitely an indeterminate form. So what can we do with this problem? Now, I know you remember that if you have a power to a power and you're taking a limit, you need a natural log. So what you can do is start off by saying y equals this function, 1 plus, or make it into a function. There we go, okay? And then you can take the natural log. So I have the natural log of y is equal to the natural log of 1 plus 1 over x to the x power. Why am I doing this natural log thing? It's so I can use the property that when you have an exponent inside a logarithm, you can move that exponent in the front. That's really why we need this. So we have the natural log of y equals x times the natural log of 1 plus 1 over x. You may be concerned about, listen, our limit is not the natural log. We'll handle this natural log in front later. Let's just take this limit now. So I'm going to take the limit as x approaches 0 from the right of x times the natural log of 1 plus 1 over x. Now what type is that? Well, that's a 0 times infinity. We still have an indeterminate form, right? Because if I plug in 0 here, that makes that infinity. Add 1, 2, it still makes infinity. Take the natural log, it's still infinity. So that means I need to use L'Hopital's rule. So there's my little star equal sign. But now, wait a minute, let's don't do that yet, because it's not a quotient, right? So I'm still in the rewrite stage. I've got the limit as x goes to 0 from the right. Let's take this to the denominator. So this is going to be the natural log of 1 plus 1 over x. And now that in the denominator is 1 over x. It seems convoluted, but I've got to write this as a fraction. So that's an equivalent statement. Now I can use my little star equal sign. So the derivative of the numerator is going to be 1 over 1 plus 1 over x, right? That's the derivative of natural log times the derivative of the inside. So the derivative of 1 is 0. The derivative of 1 over x, once again, we're thinking about is x to the negative 1. So it'd be negative x to the negative 2 power. Divided by, in the denominator, negative x to the negative 2 power. And I'm still taking the limit as x goes to 0 from the right. I forgot to write it. Now let's just simplify that. Those cancel. So I'm taking the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of 1 over 1 plus 1 over x. Now when I do that, when I plug 0 in here, 1 over 0 goes to infinity. And then I have 1 over infinity plus 1, which means that goes to 0. Now, my answer is not 0. Remember, what we have now is natural log of y is equal to 0. I've got to solve this equation. So e to the natural log of y equals e to the 0, which gives me y is equal e to the 0, which is 1. So my limit value is 1. So for example, we're going to take the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of x to the 1 over x. So when we check the form, we plug 0 in for x, and then that would be to the 1 over 0. Now let's think about that. The base is still 0. Now 1 over 0, you know, again, this is a limit, so we're getting closer and closer to 0. Well, that fraction is going to blow up to something big, right? Because you're doing 1 divided by a really small number. So that gives you the form of 0 to infinity. Now if we go look at our list, notice we have 1 to infinity. That's not what we're talking about. We have infinity to the 0 is an indeterminate form. And 0 to the 0, and this is not an oversight, 0 to the infinity, which is what we were looking for, is not an indeterminate form. So this is the reason you need to check them every time. So this is definitely not indeterminate. Well, if it's not indeterminate, that means we can determine it right off the bat. And actually, 0 to the infinity is 0, okay? Now, if we were supposed to take the limit using our regular rules without just looking at it and saying, oh, that's 0, here's what we could do. Again, you have a variable to a variable power, right? Whenever you have a variable as a base and a variable as an exponent, the way to go is to take the natural log of both sides, and then you say, wait a minute, I don't have two sides, I just have an expression. So what you want to do is you want to let y equal x to the 1 over x power. Then you can take the natural log of both sides. So you have the natural log of y is equal to the natural log of x to the 1 over x. Now why are we doing that? That's so we can move this 1 over x in front. So now I have the natural log of y equals 1 over x times the natural log of x. Now I want to take the limit as x approaches 0 from the right of 1 over x times the natural log of x. Now remember, this was not an indeterminate form. So if it's not, we can't use L'Hopital's rule. You could check the form again. 1 over, now we're approaching 0 from the right, so that's going to 0. But if you have 1 over 0, that is an infinity situation. Okay, it was 0 from the right, so you're talking about positive numbers, times the natural log of, again, we're going to 0 from the right. I know you can't plug in 0, but going to 0 from the right of natural log. Remember what natural log looks like? As we approach 0 from the right, it goes to negative infinity. Now that looks like it ought to be some kind of indeterminate form, but no, think about it. Positive infinity times a negative infinity is just negative infinity. Now don't stop there. Remember, you took the natural log of both sides. So now what we know is that the natural log of y is equal to negative infinity. Well, we have to still solve for y. So what I have to do is exponentiate both sides. So I can say e to the natural log of y is equal to e to the negative infinity. The reason we did that is so we get y back. E to the negative infinity, all right? Now, remember, this is e to a super big negative, well, super small, really, exponent. Another way to think about that is 1 over e to the infinity. That ought to help you. That goes to 0. Now, we already said it was 0, because 0 raised to the infinity power is 0 times 0 times 0 times 0 times 0 forever, right? Which is 0, but we proved it a different way. It was fun, wasn't it? Not even an indeterminate form. Next example, and I only have 3 more. Okay, so as we plug in infinity, let's check our form. So that would be 1 plus infinity, we know that's going to be infinity, to the 1 over infinity power. Now 1 plus infinity, you know, is still infinity, right? But 1 divided by infinity, that's 0. Anytime you have a constant over infinity, that goes to 0. Now remember, we just did 0 to infinity, and that was an indeterminate form, that was 0. But guess what? Infinity to the 0 is definitely an indeterminate form. There it is right there. It's our second one on the column list there at the end. So infinity to the 0 power is an indeterminate form. So what does that mean? That means, well, if we can figure out how to write this as a fraction, we could use L'Hopital's rule. But what I want you to think about is, once again, you have a variable as a base and a variable as an exponent. So whenever you have a variable to a variable power, you need to do that natural log trick. So what I'm going to do is, at first I'm going to say y equals 1 plus x to the 1 over x power. Then I'm going to evaluate the natural log of both sides. Why am I doing that? So I can move that 1 over x in front. So now I have the natural log of y is equal to 1 over x times the natural log of 1 plus x. Now I want to take the limit, okay? Remember, we're taking the limit as x approaches infinity of 1 over x times the natural log of 1 plus x. It's probably a good idea to check our type again. So if I plug infinity into 1 over x, I get 1 over infinity, which goes to 0. And if I plug infinity here, that'd be the natural log of infinity, which goes to infinity. We've already decided that's an indeterminate form, so I am allowed to use L'Hopital's rule. So I have the limit as x approaches infinity. Now, this is already a fraction, isn't it? I could write this as the natural log of 1 plus x over x. And now I'm going to take the derivative of just the numerator, which would be 1 over 1 plus x times the derivative of the inside, which is 1, divided by just the derivative of the denominator, which is 1, which really just means I'm taking the limit as x goes to infinity of 1 over 1 plus x. And if I plug infinity right there for that x value, that'd give me 1 over infinity, which is 0. Now remember, we're not done, because way back over here, we took the natural log of both sides. And if you do that, you are not finished once you take your limit right there, because you still have to do that last step and say that natural log of y is equal to 0. Not the original one limit equal to 0, but the natural log of y equals 0, and then I exponentiate both sides. So I do e to the natural log of y equals e to the 0, and we know e to the 0 is 1, so the answer to this original problem is 1. Alright, next problem, let's plug in 4 to see if we even have an indeterminate form. So that would be, okay, for problem K, we've got the limit as x goes to 4 from the right of 3 times x minus 4 raised to the x minus 4 power. So remember, the first step is to just substitute your value in and see what kind of form you have. So I have 3 times 4 minus 4 raised to the 4 minus 4 power. Now we've got 0 here, 3 times 0 is 0 to the 0. Now if you'll recall, and we'll go back to that page, 0 to the 0 is definitely an indeterminate form. It's the third one in our column down there of a list of indeterminate forms. So that means we can use L'Hopital's rule. Well, to use L'Hopital's rule, you have to have a quotient. Not only that, notice our problem is a variable as the base and a variable as an exponent. So that's like we've done the last couple of problems. We need to use the natural log of both sides. Okay, so I have the natural log of y is the natural log of 3 times x minus 4, all raised to the x minus 4 power. Why did I do that? So I can move that variable exponent in the front of my logarithm. So now I have the natural log of y is equal to x minus 4 times the natural log of 3 times x minus 4. Now my problem is that's not even a quotient. So to make it a quotient, I'm going to take this guy right here to the denominator. So now I have the natural log of y is equal to the natural log of 3 times x minus 4 divided by 1 over x minus 4. And then I'm going to the derivative of the numerator and the denominator, in other words, use L'Hopital's rule. And so I'm going to have the limit as x goes to 4 from the right. Now I'm going to be taking the derivative of the numerator. So you remember, the derivative of a natural log is 1 over the argument, so 1 over 3 times x minus 4 times the derivative of the argument. I'm using the chain rule, so times 3 divided by, now I'm also taking the derivative separately of the denominator, and I'm thinking about that denominator is x minus 4 to the negative 1. So when I take the derivative, it's going to be negative in front using the power rule, x minus 4 to the negative 2 power. Now let's simplify that as much as we can. This 3 cancels with that 3, right? And so that's going to give me the limit as x goes to 4 from the right of 1 over x minus 4 divided by negative 1 over x minus 4 squared. Now, if I invert and multiply, you think about what we have, the limit as x goes to 4 from the right, that's going to give me, the two negatives are overall going to make that a negative. I'm sorry, not the two negatives, but the positive divided by a negative is overall negative. And then this x minus 4 squared, if you flip it, you're going to have an x minus 4 squared on top and an x minus 4 in the denominator, which is going to leave us with x minus 4. You see that? And that's going to, when I plug 4 into that from the right, that's going to give me 0. But remember, I'm not finished because I took the natural log. So now I have the natural log of y is equal to 0. And I exponentiate both sides. So e to the natural log of y is equal to e to the 0. So my answer, my final answer to this problem is 1. So the last problem I have for you here, if we plug in 2, look down here. So I would have 1 over 2 squared minus 4 minus the square root of 2 minus 1 over 2 squared minus 4. Now let's think about what that's going to give me. That's 1 over 0 minus, once again, 1 over 0. Now y'all, that's not 0. I guess it could be, but it's more like infinity minus infinity. Now, that's my type. Is it on the list? And if you look, it's last on the list. You can't say infinity minus infinity is 0. Now, of course, if they were the same size infinity, I guess that would be a reasonable thing to say, that it's equal to 0. But one of those infinities might be bigger than the other one, and therefore we can't safely say that's 0. So our goal is to use L'Hopital's rule. We could if we had a function divided by another function. And you see that we have two separate fractions. So let's write this as one fraction. So I'm going to say this is the limit as x approaches 2 from the right. Okay. Now we have a common denominator already. So I can say this is 1 minus the square root of x minus 1. Divided by x squared minus 4. It's helpful that we already had a common denominator. Now you could check the type again. So if I plug 2 in here, I get 0. If I plug 2 in here, over 0. And that is definitely an indeterminate form. So what I want to do is use L'Hopital's rule. So as the limit as x goes to 2 from the right, I take the derivative of the numerator. You know the derivative of 1 is 0. The derivative of this, I think it would help if you think about that as x minus 1 to the 1/2 power. So I'm going to say the negative just comes down. And 1/2 in front, x minus 1, 1/2 minus 1 is negative 1/2. And separately, I'm going to take the derivative of the denominator, which is 2x. And then you simply just take the limit of this instead. Now, to do that, we want to simplify it as much as we can, so that's what I'm going to do next. I have the limit as x approaches 2 from the right. This 2 I could take to the denominator. Matter of fact, I could take that whole thing to the denominator, can I? So I have a negative 1 on top from here. And then this is going to be this 2 times this 2x is going to be 4x. And then that's going to be the square root of x minus 1, isn't it? And if I plug 2 into that value instead, I get negative 1 over 4 times 2 times the square root of 2 minus 1, which is negative 1 over 8 times the square root of 1, which is just negative 1/8. And that's my limit value. So to sum things up, the idea is you check to see what form you have. If you can just take the limit outright, and you don't get an indeterminate form, then do that. But if you get an indeterminate form, remember we could go back and look at our list of indeterminate forms. There's a bunch of them. So you've got 0 over 0. You've got infinity over infinity, negative infinity over infinity. And you can move that negative around or even have negative infinity over negative infinity. Those are already the ones that are in quotient form. Well, what if it's not in quotient form? 1 to the infinity power is indeterminate. 0 to infinity, 0 to 0, 0 times infinity, and infinity minus infinity. And then we run into examples that are not indeterminate forms. So for example, infinity plus infinity is not infinity, right? That's just going to give you infinity, I mean not indeterminate is just going to give you infinity. Or negative infinity minus infinity is going to give you negative infinity. So these are not indeterminate. Infinity times infinity, or infinity times negative infinity, is going to give you infinity. And zero to infinity, that is not an indeterminate form. Now, the reverse is right there. It is. The zero to infinity gives you zero. So, first of all, you got to determine, is it in the indeterminate form? And then if it is, you got to write it as a fraction. And then once you do that, you take the derivative of the numerator, derivative of the denominator separately, and evaluate if it's an indeterminate form again. If it is, you can do those derivatives again. Use L'Hopital's rule more than once. But as soon as you get an answer for your limit, or plus or minus infinity, then you're finished. Be careful, if you have a variable raised to a variable power, then you will need to take the natural log of both sides, and you'll have an extra step at the end. So let me know if you have any questions about this, and I hope you have a wonderful day.